Here is the NEC P3 mobile phone. In this video, we'll have a technical look into a phone released in 1990 and find out how this model was used to subvert the operation of cellular networks around the world. Back in the mid-80s, the first ever cellular phone networks were built, and the phones that used them were bricks. In 1990, one of the best models to come out was the NEC P3.
In communications, there's a stylish new leader, a smart and compact design that responds to your personal touch to connect you with unsurpassed clarity. The new NEC portable phone. Future communications in a style of today. NEC.
This is a first generation or 1G phone, which means you could make and receive calls, and that's it. Sporting NEC's original logo design, this model featured a quarter wave antenna that could be flipped into an upright position for better reception. Better still, an option to attach a half wave antenna not only gave excellent reception, but gave the phone more of a military radio look. Okay, let's remove that battery. And we have a 700 milliamp hour NiCad. Since this battery is dead, I've made a dummy battery from a spare dead battery. And as well as the two dummy battery power wires, you can see I've added four extra wires, and we'll find out about that a bit later. For now, we do have power up, and it's 12 a.m. And we can see that it does say no service. So this phone hasn't been near a 1G tower in 20 years. And that's due to all the 1G networks having been shut down around the world. I could quite easily build a base station using a software-defined radio and this project mentioned on Hackaday. At the end of the article, it notes that if nobody reports you, you could probably get away with it. I wouldn't though. Without a radio license, I don't think it's worth the risk. So one of the things I do want to do is hear the ringtone. So let's see if we can find it. So we've got function, call tone, off, ringtone. Wow, there we go. That is amazing. So if we do try to make a call, it won't go through. In use, we can just hear a tone coming through, indicating that it can't really get a network. There is an extensive test mode in this phone, but it needs a dongle to activate. The service manual shows a picture of one of the dongles. This one is a NAM, or Number Assignment Module dongle, for programming the phone number when connecting a service at a dealership. Instead, using the wires I've added, I can enable all test commands using software I'll describe a bit later. Okay, it's done, and I've got test mode active on the phone, now ready to start mucking about with this thing. Now, I do have a list of all the commands here, and there's pages of this. So, looks like we can have a status display to tell us what the phone is doing. And I want to look for a specific command. There we go. Out of all the commands, this one is most interesting. This will turn the phone into a cellular radio scanner. Recall hash 69 channel 1. There it goes, so it's scanning. I've got to learn how to turn on the ear speaker or loudspeaker. Find that command. RX unmute, recall hash 12. Recall hash 12. Okay. Okay, that's really quite loud, but it is scanning through all the channels. And if we had an active network, it would actually pick up people's private phone calls. Okay, so that's the scanning function that's actually built into the test mode on the phone. And using that, you could actually, at the time, listen into other people's private phone calls. For an example of what that was like, there's a somewhat controversial movie because it misrepresented the hacker that it was about. The movie's called Takedown from the year 2000, and it dramatized this function. Here's a clip.
Please proceed with your demonstration.
What I have in my hand, Mr. Chairman, is a cell phone sold by the Nokitel Corporation. But really, it's a flexible radio controlled by a small computer. That is, a scanner.
Babe, can you make it to the beach house next weekend? Newmarket's still in Spain, right? With the kids.
Come on, sweetheart. I'm needed up here on the hill. I mean, all this talk about cutting back
software. I think that will be sufficient.
Beach house.
Honey, I need to get on top of you.
Enough!
And I just want to point out that the scanning features I just demonstrated were put in by the manufacturer. All I did was discover them.
As well as listening into a call, you could use the test commands to enable the transmitter and break into a phone call and actually start talking to people. I don't think this was very common, but it does highlight how vulnerable the early cellular networks were. Okay, next command, recall hash 24, recall hash 24. And that shows us the serial number. And as extensive as test mode is, there's only a read serial number. There isn't a write serial number. And the reason why it doesn't have that function is because there's no good reason to change the serial number in this phone. However, using this same cable and some DOS programs that you can get, it was possible to actually change the serial number inside this phone. Even better, there was a modified ROM available, which if you were able to burn a ROM and install it into one of these phones, not only did it give you access to full test mode without need to plug it in and enable it, you could actually change the electronic serial number from the keypad. So one of the things you could do if you could change the ESN in a phone was you could do tumbling. And that's when you change the ESN and also the phone number programmed into the phone. And then you would set it to roam onto a guest network. And back then, they didn't have instant verification. So the network would assume that you're roaming from another network and it would allow calls to go through. However, later on, when they found out that people had changed the ESN and the number programmed into the phone, the billing systems found that these were invalid, and tons of fraudulent calls were being made using this system. So network operators pretty soon upgraded their systems to prevent tumbling. After tumbling was shut down, the next thing people did was actually build scanners that looked at the channels and then picked people's serial numbers and phone numbers out of the air. These were called pairs, and there was a black market trade in pairs, and they were programmed into phones. And this was pretty rude because any calls you made using a pair was put onto that person's bill. In fact, cloning became such a huge problem that there is an article in the New York Times that reports that 4% of all phones were cloned in the United States. And I've read in other places that some countries had double-digit fraud, and on some towers in some places in the world, almost all the calls being placed on certain towers, because they were in certain areas, were all fraudulent. This was a huge problem for networks at the time, so they went to extensive measures to try and shut it down. And one thing they did was use RF signal fingerprinting. So they'd actually have a look at the analog RF signal coming out of each phone and make a record of it. Each transmitter is slightly different in the analog domain in the way it transmits a signal, and they would actually fingerprint your phone to make sure that each call was from your particular transmitter. True phone freakers, however, who weren't really interested in stealing or fraud, who were just interested in exploring the technology, for example, Steve Jobs, he was a phone freaker back in the day. Here he is talking a little bit about his phone freaking career and how if he hadn't have done that, he probably wouldn't have made his first Apple computer.
One of the things that Woz and I did was we built blue boxes. These are obsolete now, but they were devices that you could build. You know, when you make a long distance phone call in the background, you hear do-do-do-do-do-do. Those are the telephone computers actually signaling each other, sending information to each other to set up your call. And the signaling they use is a lot like touch tone phones, only it's different frequencies. Well, you can make a box that emits those frequencies, that can make those tones. And there used to be a way to fool the entire telephone system into thinking you were a telephone computer and to open up itself and let you call anywhere in the world for free.
So using test pairs means that a phone freaker could have accessed the network using the network's own test numbers, which were used for checking the network, which means there was no billing associated with them whatsoever. So you could have gotten away with a completely covert incoming and outgoing call system, providing they weren't actually testing the network at the time using the same numbers you were using to access the system. I want to do a shout out to another phone, the Oki 900, which could do everything this phone could do and had a modified ROM that allowed tumbling built in. There was even a memory map of the firmware inside the phone. That phone was truly compromised. And we can just start the disassembly process. Let's get that back off. Okay, we're in. Disconnect that antenna lead. Okay, so we'll just do a quick sweep over the main board and I'll go into some depth later. And there's the display with a heap of connections, but also on the bottom of the LCD, there's a whole other row. So we've got a battery backup and these are going to be driving the LCD. And we have an NEC custom chip here. And we have a chip under here, which I read in the service manual, that's the baseband. And we have the programmable ROM under here, and what looks to be a relay, 32.768 kilohertz crystal. That's the 8K RAM chip, and three main chips here. One of them is going to be a main CPU and then some support controllers and then the bottom connector. Okay, we'll have a look at how this all works. So I'll take the battery off. And these are where I attach the wires because I don't have a bottom connector. So just got ground and we've got data and we've got clock and we've got busy. And those wires run to a parallel port, which plugs into the computer. We've got a couple of small diodes on there as well. And on the computer, we run a program which you can find on the internet called p3test.exe. You run that in DOS with disconnected, and that's how we get test mode on this thing. Now, I do want to do a bit more of a tear down on this phone. So instead of tearing this one down, because I know it works, I'm going to tear down this one here, which I know is faulty. So I do want to see what the radio module looks like in this. And that's the antenna switching. And we've got, looks like we've got a Teledyne RF relay on that one. Okay, we've got our tape separated. Now let's see if we can lift that can away. Oh wow, there we go. There's one side of our RF section. That is amazing. So this is an analog phone, which meant most of the time when the phone was on standby, it was listening to a digital signal, the control channel, which told the phone when a call was coming in. And then as soon as a call was set up, it was switched to analog FM for voice. There's the other side of the can. So it looks like there's actually two circuit boards there. If we look through here, we can see two layers of board. So let's... There we go. Yep, we can see two blank boards with a ground plane of some copper there sitting between them. That's the NEC P3 mobile phone and the ways it took nefarious control over the early cellular phone networks.